most cases, the why we want farmers to always come for fresh seed is that they don't intend to mix the seed. But because they don't have trained eyes and they are not at times familiar, as I showed you these varieties, you told me they looked look the same.
Yes.
So it would be really, really hard for the farmer to, you know, to separate them if they were mixed. Because farmers normally grow more than one seed variety. Okay. Now, during harvest and when they are threshing, they do that by using sticks. Okay. Now, as they thresh, seeds jump from one area to another, They don't may not see that if two of these or three were mixed into this, he or she may not see them. Now, when they plant, this one bean will give rise to those, at times this is more than that, those number of seeds per season. Okay? Now, if he had 20 or 30 of them within this, okay, it means he has 20 times about 60 seeds, you know, that is mixing within that his what we call the original seed. Okay? And within one or two seasons, he's lost that because he can't now separate them anymore. Okay? So that becomes a source, first source of mixing. The other is crafty people who really want to make a killing out of the demand that happens. Okay? People buy anything from the market and at times utilize that to create their own sets of seed. And farmers lose a lot, not because they don't know, but because of such things. Yeah, that happens. But there are some measurements that one can take really to ensure that at least he has proper seed or he knows where the seed is coming from. Okay? Maif is putting into place traceability mechanisms for ensuring that this does not happen. Okay, so we are hoping in future we are going to have a very good seed system out of this. We've tried to ensure that we train farmers within the region to produce a cost-friendly seed that are good quality to enable such households to be able to yield a little bit more. Yeah, because the starting seed really has a big role to play in as far as your yields are concerned. There are certain varieties that you can grow anywhere and yield. Basically, this is a numbers game.
Yes.
Okay. For example, in an acre, one is expected to have about 80,000 plants. Okay. The first mistake that reduces yields that farmers do is not having the numbers right. And this is because of the mechanism that is used, which is chop and plant. As in, they use their hoe to chop the soil, then drop a seed and chop and drop a seed. That's a chop and plant mechanism.
Right.
When you do chop and plant, it's very hard to get 80,000 plants within an acre. In most cases, farmers get about half. Each plant has a potential yield. If it's supposed to be 60 pods, it will be 60 pods. That is potential. Okay? So if you take that, you've done the best agronomy, but you've had 40,000 plants where 80,000 plants supposed to be, you're going to get 50% of the yield. And that is the first most important aspect.
How do we get the numbers?
Either you can use mechanization, which is the easiest, or plant using lines and use the right spacing that is recommended.
Which
that is 50 meters between rows and 10 centimeters from one plant to the other. But the mechanism of getting that 10 is a technique that you can learn as you go along. Farmers lose close to 50% because of not getting the right numbers into the field. Okay, then choosing the right varieties for the right environments. For example, if you went to Karamoja, it's a sandy, mostly sandy-based soil, that is with also the fact that it has intermittent rainfall, which means there are intermittent droughts, rains break, you know. So you need a variety that really has to look at drought tolerance issues. And that's why we said you have to look for varieties that do well in those regions. They're a little bit light, they can withstand the lightness of the soil, then they're a little bit drought tolerant and also yield highly. Okay, so for example, narrow bean 6 does about 3,800 kilograms per hectare. Mm-hmm. It's about 14 bags per acre. This for the northern people is about 3,500 kilograms, and these are the two bush most yielding, but they can also do well across the country, okay, apart from the highlands. Why in the highlands? Because these are really early maturing varieties that do about 65-70 days, and the islands at times you have a lot of rains that go through, you know, throughout the year, and cool environments, so they don't really augur well with the environment. And that's why in the environment we opt for the climbers that we have the Nabetovsi. I don't have it here. So there's a Masavu that is round or kidney. Then there is a narrow bean 4C and narrow bean 5C, okay, and a whole range of 7Cs, 9Cs that are for the highland environments.
Do we have local names for those beans?
They are still Nabe 12C is also called Masavu, but the round one, okay. There is the Western people call them Mishingiriro. So, as I said, if you want to go into yellow production, it's supposed to be in the western part of the country, and this is about 2,000 kilograms per acre. Yeah. Okay, you see, it's still lower than the rest. This variety suffers a lot into when you go into other areas. It's prone to a high lot of disease pressures in the different areas. But as I said, we are trying to address some of those issues. This variety, which does about 2,000. At times 2,300, depending on the capacity, does very well everywhere.
This is the Masavu.
The Masavu that is kidney and also bush. Doesn't need the Mishingiriro we talked about. You can grow it everywhere. Even in the dry areas, it tries to do really, really well. Because it escapes, it's early maturing, it's about 60 days. We have the Kanyewa type, which is Nabe 15. It also does really well everywhere, apart from the high altitude areas. The red mottos, they are universal actually. Yeah, if you wanted to start trying beans, the first thing you look at is the red mottos. If you don't know what you want to grow, you know, because it has market, it has market, and it does well almost in all the parts of the country. Now what we've been trying to do, apart from Nabe 4, which is an old variety that does about 80-90 days. Our breeding program has been trying to reduce the growth period from about 58, which is Nabe 15, to about 75 days. And for the climbers, from 120 to about 80 to 90 days. So we are trying to, because of climate change and intermittent rainfall, we are trying to reduce now the growth period from planting to maturity. So the maximum number of days about now, for the bush about 75 days, and for the climbers about 90-92 days. So we have the potential, but because of issues, for example, we know that the potential for a plant may be about 60 pods. But we know in between, each flower is supposed to be a pod, but some flowers drop off because of either rain being hit, or because of somebody going through the field, or because of irrigation, somebody was applying irrigation and flowers drop off, or because there was a lot of heat that came through and there was abortion, okay? So normally we don't get the potential. We at times have a certain amount that farmers really really get. For this, you'll need about 15 to about 20 kilograms per acre. And we expect the least a farmer should get should be about 6 to about 8 bags per acre. For the red kidneys, the bags about still 7, 6, you know, 5, depending on, you know, the management. And this one also is about 7, 8 bags per acre. It's very, very good yield. The issue of fex seed is in twofold or threefold. The first instance is where it's actually done because of the demand. The demand is high, people go out to the market and buy whatever they buy, and you know. But as I said, that is being addressed by Maif, Naro, and so very soon that will be history. The second one is farmer not knowing what they want. If you bought seed, I request the farmer, the first thing you have to look at is uniformity, okay? Because that's where it starts from. If the seed you're buying should be kidney, because for seed, there are three issues you look at. Seed size, seed shape, and seed color. Somebody may have bought something else mixed together with something else. They may be good seed, but when mixed, then they become fake seed. First of all, when you look at this seed, you will see two distinct different colors in there, okay? It's already mottled, but you are seeing some a little bit white. Why are they white? You ask yourself, why are they white? And others are brown or have a dark color, okay? So that already tells you that there is a mixture of some sort. So when you sort these ones out, you see that now you have a little bit of uniformity.
Yes.
Okay? The third thing that they could do is do a simple germination test. Because if already the seed is uniform, okay, if the seed is uniform, then I can do a simple test like a germination test. I can take out 100 seeds of that or 10 or 50 seeds and just put it either in wrap it in a paper, moist it up, put it aside for 3-4 days to see whether the seed germinates. If it doesn't, then it doesn't need me to take the seed that is not germinating into the field.
Well, I just enjoy having these conversations with Dr. Stanley Mkaruvo. He has actually told us so much about, you know, choosing the right seed to plant come the bean planting season. That is just around the corner. If I got him right, he has said very key issues. As a farmer, when you're going to choose a seed variety to plant, you just have to pay attention. Pay attention. Look at the seed size, look at the seed shape, and look at the color. Those are three important things to look at so that you get the right seed. We wish you all the best come the, you know, new planting season, that is March. I have been your host, Jackie Chan. When we come back with our next episode of the Harvest Money Show, we shall be talking how to manage your, you know, crops, the beans you've planted.